Hey, Andre, this is a very special episode of Talking Trucks because we are all about big rigs.
We usually talk about heavy-duty pickup trucks, but we're going bigger on this episode. Bigger and bolder, and actually really important stuff.
Yeah, for those of you who don't know, Andre does have his CDL, commercial driver's license.
Yes.
And so recently, you had a little bit of a treat. You got to go to the introduction of the new Freightliner Cascadia.
Yeah, I did. This was in Detroit area. It was a world debut of the updated fifth generation Cascadia. And if you don't know this world, probably you might be driving to work right now listening to this podcast. And next to you might be a semi-truck. And it's very likely it's a Freightliner because it's the best seller.
Well,
I
would say it's a Mercedes.
It's a Daimler.
It's a Daimler. That's right.
Yes.
So, as you know, Daimler owns Freightliner. They also own what was once a very popular brand, Detroit Diesel.
Yes.
And all of the Detroit Diesel parts that go along with that.
Yeah, exactly.
So the world of semi-trucks is usually not in our wheelhouse, so at least I certainly am no expert. Are you an expert, Andre?
No, I do have a CDL.
Okay.
Right, so I'm equipped and I'm licensed to drive a big rig with air brakes. I'm not licensed to drive a big rig with a manual transmission because I did not do extra schooling and the extra testing that was required to drive a manual transmission.
Are there actually big rigs with manuals anymore?
I think 2% of new trucks,
yeah,
big rigs sold have manuals.
I know it's very manly to shift your own gears, but yeah. Jesus Christ, if you got 18 of them and three different sets of
shift levers,
yeah, I could see having automatic being very, very nice. And what does that? What does air brake mean? What does that mean?
Air brakes means so in your car or pickup truck, it's usually hydraulic brakes, which means when you push on the pedal, it actually pushes fluid through the lines in your truck or car, and that fluid squeezes the pads and brakes. But in a big rig like this, air brakes, basically air pressure is being used to apply brakes, and also heavy springs. So it's an air brake actuated system, air actuated system. It's a little bit different.
Hey, podcast listeners and TFL Talk viewers. I wanted to take a minute to talk to you about a quick and simple way to sell your car or truck with the help of our new partner, HiRoad. With HiRoad's online portal, you enter your vehicle's VIN number or plate, mileage, and zip code, and you'll get competing offers from several qualified dealers in your area within seconds. You pick the best deal offered and follow through with the dealer to sell your vehicle. No more managing scammy emails from buyers on Craigslist or Facebook Marketplace. No more time wasted on no-show buyers. No bait and switch with a "will you take a check" excuse from sketchy buyers. Now keep in mind, these offers will be for trade-in values of your vehicle. If you want to go through the hassle of getting more for your vehicle, that's up to you. But if you want to sell your vehicle hassle-free and fast, go to tfltruck.com and click Sell Your Truck in the navigation menu. Or click on the HiRoad ad at the bottom of the website if you're on mobile, or click on the column if you're on a desktop. HiRoad makes it easy, and we like easy.
So why do you need a special license for that? Is it more prone to failure, or is it just more sophisticated so you can handle these very heavy loads that these semi-trucks are hauling?
I think, and once again, I'm not an ultimate expert because I don't drive a big rig every day, like some of listeners are probably driving big rigs. But you have to inspect the system every trip. Sure. You have to do a pre-trip inspection, which means leaks. You're checking for leaks. You're checking for water, in the system because air has humidity, right?
Yeah. When those brakes fail, like happened not that long ago here in Denver, and a semi truck came down the mountains, basically created a horrible pileup. Lots of people died. I mean, we're talking life and death. And by the way, guys, just so you know, you won't be staring at our mugs if you're watching this the whole time because Andre did interview. Who did you interview for this podcast?
So, so this is not just a Roman and Andre show today. Yeah. We have an expert interview.
Okay.
So I spoke with Miranda. She is on the team at Freightliner, and she basically told me a lot of good insights about this truck. So there's an interview there. So that's going to be.
Did you do a walk around?
Yes.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, Miranda and I walked around a couple trucks actually, and I tried to ask her some tough questions because it's not just about you know, tell me the specs, right? It's not just because of that. It's also, why did you do this, right? Why did you not update the engine? Why did you do this? Why did you update the camera systems? And so on and on and on and on.
And did they, I have to ask, did they electrify it at all? I know that's happening in the truck world as well.
It's not a hybrid, no. Mm.
All right.
And it's also kind of, the electric system is new. Mm. So basically kind of the nervous system of the truck is new. But it's not a 48-volt system. It's a, still a 12-volt system like you would have on your pickup truck. And also, after I speak with Miranda, Cole and I, Cole, our videographer and producer, we also checked out some Detroit parts.
Oh, cool. The
engines, transmissions, axles.
That's so cool, Andre.
Yeah.
All right, so before we get to that, you were saying initially that Freightliner is the most popular big rig on the road.
Yeah.
The tractor part. So it's tractor-trailer, right?
Yeah.
So tractor is the truck part. I see a lot of Volvos out there, but do you have numbers?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah.
So thankfully, I met some amazing people at this event.
Okay.
In the industry. You know, journalists who follow fleets and big rigs and all this very, very carefully. So I met a nice gentleman, Josh Fisher, and he works at fleetowner.com. So basically, it's a website dedicated to fleet owners and managers. And he gave me some data. So here, if you're watching this on YouTube, he gave me some sales numbers. And this is from, let's see, 2023. So it's not like
correct.
The latest, yeah. You know, this month. But this was, you know, just from a few months ago. And you said Volvo, right?
Right.
So Volvo had about 10% of the market.
Okay. Well, that's all right.
So, I mean, yes.
Yeah,
but they're very distinctive, right? Volvo trucks, you know,
right.
You can't miss them. You
yes.
know, they have a really nice logo and bam, it's right there.
Start at the bottom and work your way up. So what's the least popular and most popular brand?
So this data by okay. fleetowner.com is tracking Tesla Semi.
Oh, so
And they have 0%, 0.0.
Okay.
Okay, that's not quite zero, but
I mean, they're running, they're out there.
Because there's a few running. But so Pepsi company bought several, or maybe they leased them. They got several semi-trucks, fully electric trucks from Tesla, and they're using them. And, you know, there's a lot of news about it. But at least as far as this data is concerned in 2023, it's almost 0%.
Yeah, so if you went far enough down the decimal point, it'd be like 0.00001.
Something, yes.
Yeah, something like that. Okay, yes. But what's next?
Next up on the list is Western Star.
Oh, sure. Yeah,
Western Star, you may see that big W, right, on the hood, right? Western Star is also owned by Daimler.
Sorry.
Are you okay?
Yeah.
Okay, so Western Star is also owned by Daimler, and they have 3.1% of... And we're talking about class 8 kind of long-haul truckers. So we're not talking about like garbage trucks or dump trucks or cranes. We're talking about long-haul trucking.
Gotcha. All right. What's number 7 if we're going up? Or what?
Yes.
I don't know how many you got there.
Yes. So the next on the list going up in popularity is Mack.
I'm going to get some water. I'll be right
yes.
back. Keep going. You go.
So we have Mack Truck. At 6.8%, and their share was growing just a little tiny bit. And I love the brand. I love Mack Truck. They have that awesome logo. And so next on the list is Volvo. This is number, let's see, 5 out of 8 on this list is Volvo at 10%. So Volvo VNL big rigs are also... very, very popular, and there's lots of them. So Volvo is number 5 on our list. Number 4 is International. And now it's getting interesting, Roman, because yep. number 4 through 2, so the next 3 on the list, are super close, and they're clawing at each other as far as sales. So International is number 4 at 13.9%, with share of those trucks growing. Number 3 is Kenworth. With 14.7, so within 1 percentage point. And number 2 on our list is Peterbilt with 14.9. So Peterbilt and Kenworth are together. They're owned by PACCAR. So they have about, 14.9 plus 14.7, about 25%. No, I'm sorry. 29%.
According to that graph, it looks like Freightliner owns much more of the market than any of those other truck companies.
And Freightliner is 36.5.
Yeah, so
it's kind of a gorilla. I mean, even if you combine Peterbilt and Kenworth together, they're still not quite as much as Freightliner. So this is a big deal when they introduce a new truck.
Yeah, I bet. So what makes it special before we get, I'm sure we'll go over it with the video, but in your opinion, what makes it special? Or did they do enough?
So I tried to look at so much data, Roman. I was preparing for this trip, you know, when I went to Detroit to see the new Freight Cascadia, and I saw a couple of common threads. What I was seeing was Freightliner is maybe one of the more affordable ones.
Okay, that's
good. That matters, yep. You know, for many operators.
What does that mean in numbers?
It's hard to say because it depends on the size of your purchasing power. You know, if you're Amazon and you're buying, you know, 200 trucks tomorrow,
then you're going to get a discount.
You're getting a discount because you're buying a lot of trucks.
Or leasing.
But I think we're dealing with about 150,000 per truck. So maybe 160, maybe 170. So we're kind of in this zone of about $150,000 to $170,000 per truck.
Per tractor.
Per tractor. Yeah. But this number can change. Like I said, Amazon may be paying a little bit less. Okay. Walmart may be paying a little bit less. It just depends on kind of, you know, how big your fleet is and, you know, your relationship with the manufacturer.
I would think like, you know, reliability, fuel economy, ease of you know, driving comfort. These are the things that people, I mean, these are not like sports cars, right? These are utility vehicles. And so,
and they're offices and homes on wheels, right?
Yeah.
Because, you know, they have bunk beds, they have microwaves, they have refrigerators, some of these, you know, longer trucks with, you know, sleeping quarters, and these long haul rigs, you know, are an office. It's also a home. So it has to work all in one. You know our friend Dan Atkinson, right?
Yeah.
He drives a Freightliner.
Okay, yeah, makes sense.
And he's had his Freightliner since, 2018 or 2017? So, and he's a single owner operator, right? So he bought a truck just for his business by himself. He's not part of any fleet. And so he's working his Freightliner as we speak.
So what's under the hood, dude?
So a selection of engines. So you can get a DD, Detroit Diesel, 13. 13 stands for liters.
Mm-hmm.
You can get a DD 15.
15 liter?
15 liters.
Yep.
And these are all straight sixes, my friend.
Are they turbos?
Of course. Yep. Yeah, they're turbocharged diesels. And that's when we talk, you know, when we talk Cummins, yep. Right, in the Ram trucks, that's also a straight six engine. So big rigs mostly now use straight six orientation engines.
Yeah, except the pistons are huge. If it's a 15 liter,
it's
a displacement. Oh my God.
It's more than twice the displacement of a Cummins in a Ram, right? Because that's a 6.7 liter engine. They also have Cummins engines. So Cummins sells big rig engines. And in 2026, Cummins is going to introduce for this long haul type of truck a natural gas-powered straight six.
Yeah.
So, because emissions are, you know, really important as well.
Do they also have DEF, do you know?
Yes, they do.
They have to write DEF, okay. Yeah. Diesel emission fluid, for those of you guys not familiar.
Yeah. And, you know, DEF, I mean, it's a whole controversy. There were several controversies I noticed about big rigs. First of all, the demise of the manual transmission, you know. A lot of, you know, old school truckers will still tell you, let me shift my own gears. You know, I want to control the truck and control the load and, you know, control everything. Then that was phased out by the automated manual.
Yeah.
Basically, there's a computer shifting for you.
Yeah.
Right. Those are 12 speeds now. Then there is a introduction of like cruise control systems and, you know, not electrification, but like driver assistance technologies.
Same thing we're seeing in cars.
Yeah, basically. Yeah.
Full self truck driving.
Almost. Actually, this new Cascadia is quite impressive, dude. So I also have a video. So if you can check out oldtfl.com, I also have kind of a demonstration where I was driving the truck and also being driven in it for several demonstrations.
How much will it haul? Is it still 80,000 pounds?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because this is not electrified, yep. So combined weight is still 80,000 pounds. If it was electrified, for example, Tesla, they allow a little bit extra weight, so 82,000 pounds.
Because you're using a lot of that payload goes to battery.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And what's kind of fuel economy? Did they up the fuel economy?
By aerodynamic efficiency, Roman,
yeah,
of this sleek front end on the new Cascadia improved by 1.9%.
Which could translate to, you know, really a lot of fuel economy gain over tens of thousands of miles, which, yeah, these guys put on. I never understood, like, the flat-nose trucks that they have in Europe, right? We have them here as well, right?
Cabovers.
Yeah, but those seem really un-aerodynamic.
Well, you know what?
I'm sure they're great for, like, sight lines, right? If you're trying to go within a tight space, you can see exactly where the front of that truck is. But, man, it can't be great for fuel economy.
No, and that's an interesting question. And there's a lot of sentiment also that Europeans have better semi-truck technology. Mm.
They certainly have better semi-truck racing.
They have semi-truck racing.
Yeah.
Yes. But you're right, dude. How efficient is it pushing a brick wall through the, wind?
I don't get that. There must be some reason for that.
But maybe, well, first of all, there's several reasons. In Europe, there's length restrictions, right? So trucks have to be not as long.
Yeah, so you can't have a long hood.
Yeah, long hood. So there's one restriction. There's also, I don't know.
We're getting out of our depth here. So you know what? As we're getting out of our depth, why don't we go back to the people who know this stuff, mm-hmm, as opposed to me and you speculating on it. And let's cut to that video and the walkarounds that you shot, because frankly, I think people want to see the truck and not us.
Yeah, and also, yeah.
Or hear about the truck and not from us, from
and
the experts.
Hear about the features and the reasoning behind it. And Miranda is really, really good.
Miranda, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Can you please introduce yourself?
Yes, I am Miranda Richardson. I work for Daimler Truck North America, and I'm the on-highway product marketing manager.
And this is a big deal. So I don't review semi-trucks every day. We're focused on pickup trucks. But this is the best seller, right? I mean, the Cascadia is the best seller, at least in United States.
Yes.
So this is like, you know, an F-150 or a Silverado 1500. So it's a huge deal, and this is a new generation of the truck.
That is correct, yes.
Fifth generation.
The fifth generation Cascadia. This is our flagship product, and we are so excited to be able to bring it to the market with all of its new changes.
All right, so let's start with styling, I think, in the front, and then we'll dig into each area a little bit more. So let's stand back a little bit and kind of take a look at it.
Yeah, well, to start off this from just a configuration standpoint, this is the fifth generation Cascadia. It is a 116 BBC, so that's just the length from the front to the back of the cab. Under the hood, we have a DD13 and a DT12, so it has full Detroit powertrain integration there, which is something that we're very prideful coming from our proprietary lineup here. Some changes that you'll notice kind of right off the bat compared to our current Cascadia that we have is the updated bumper. So the first piece here is that we have a great two-piece bumper system, mm-hmm, that our customers have known to love for its durability, but we're now able on the fifth generation to introduce air ducts into the bumper. And so what this does is helps guide air around the front of the truck and out past the wheel well here, because in the wheel well, that is a huge wake region for air. And so we try to keep it out from under there. It eliminates drag and gives overall better fuel economy.
Let me take a look at that, because you can kind of see daylight. So,
yep.
So Cole, if you can kind of point your camera there and you can kind of see us
side. Yep.
I also sometimes call it the air curtain.
Yeah.
Some other vehicles sometimes have these kind of devices.
Yes.
For the air curtain on the side.
Yeah. And not only does it provide a fuel efficiency improvement, but it also helps air and temperature under the wheel well. So it helps from maintaining cooling temperatures for the brakes as well, just to make sure that everything stays cool under there and keeps all drivers safe on the road.
Because efficiency is most important.
Efficiency,
right?
is one
of the
important.
Big things,
yes.
Right? Because, and for this new generation, you tackled efficiency with aerodynamics,
correct,
basically.
Okay. Yes. Yep. And that's not the only changes, too, from an aerodynamics to the bumper. You'll notice this. So this is what we call an air dam here.
Okay.
So it's three pieces. So one here, and then one over here. And this also protects all those important components under the hood. So making sure, you know, the engine, transmission, all that stays
safe.
Some debris, keeps that. It also helps, again, from keeping that airflow under the truck, right? And the great thing about this is, I mentioned it's three pieces, so it's got these snap enclosures here. So it's easy for technicians to pop on and off should they need to access under the truck. But also, if you need to replace any piece of it, you don't have to replace the whole thing. So it's also a cost-effective solution in the fact that only have to replace the damaged areas as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, and then the upper area is split into two
yeah,
pieces
so this
as
is
well.
This is the bumper piece here. So okay. You get the same great benefit of the being a two-piece bumper as well from a replacement the total cost of ownership perspective.
And I can see, like, you can mount your license plates in
yep.
different locations too.
Correct. And then the great thing while we're down here, really not on the aerodynamics, but something to point out while we're at this angle, is that we are very focused on safety just as much as efficiency.
Yeah.
And so we've able to now introduce additional radars for more safety features. And right here houses our long range radar there. So it gives us better detection. We can detect more objects as well. And so that's kind of some of the major changes that you're going to see right here to the front.
And obviously the grille is new as well.
The grille is new. We have two options. This option that you're seeing here is our solid black molden color option. No changes to surface area, still provides the same great cooling and protection under the hood, but more just a new styling update to bring it that modern, sleek look that we see a lot of, you know, automobiles even moving to as well. So same for the trucking industry there.
All right, and then kind of the height of the hood and the slope of the hood is similar to before?
It is. No changes to the height or slope of the hood.
Okay.
They do have aerodynamic styling lines here.
Okay.
So again, sticking to that same message from aerodynamics and fuel efficiency really helps guide airflow around the hood of the truck, keeping it moving down the sides. So that's going to be the big changes that you see to the top of the hood. But one of the big reasons why we had to change the hood was to incorporate the new headlights.
Because that's built into one piece.
It is
of,
a
right?
one piece okay. system now. So these are our dual stage intelligent LED headlights. They are impact and impact resistant. So increased durability there, hopefully eliminating some need for replacements. But what's great about these is it's a 30% light pattern improvement. So it offers a 45 degree breadth of light of illuminated area in front of the truck, which is a huge increase. And so
it's now wider. Is it also a little bit further down the
yep,
line?
It's okay. wider and further.
Okay.
There's such improvement that we've now eliminated the need to have fog lights. So now you no longer have to have those fog lights into the bumper of the truck.
So it's kind of a cost improvement.
It is. Just to, you know, cost and safety, right?
Yeah.
And then two, what's great about these is the dual stage piece of it is no matter if you're in cold climate or hot climate, they de-ice and defog. And the driver has to do nothing for that. They use an ambient air temp sensor, which is in the side of the mirror there. But they use that ambient air temp sensor and they automatically de-ice or defog with a heating component in them to keep that visibility.
Kind of what we're
seeing? Yes, the power grids there. Because, you know, LED lights aren't known for being their warmth,
yeah,
right?
They're
now with this, you don't have to worry about that. So that's what's really great about it.
And I can see there's another radar down here.
Yep. So just like I mentioned, we added the long-range radar right there under the grille. We now have a short-range radar here and on the other side as well. So what's great about all of these radars, whether they're on the front of the truck or on the side fairings over there.
Yeah, we can see it there.
Yep. They all work together and they are able to provide us enhanced safety features, keeping not only the driver, but all of the vehicles around the driver safe on the road.
All right, so we talked a little bit about styling up front.
Mm-hmm.
So overall, according to Freightliner, it's about 1.9% improvement.
Yep, it's a 1.9% aero just from exterior enhancements.
Just exterior.
Yes.
Oh, we didn't talk about the A-pillar.
Oh, yes, great.
And then we'll dig into safety later because that's another critical component. And of course, the common theme is profitability, which is cost of ownership,
mm-hmm.
right? So those are the three themes like we're kind of talking through.
Exactly, yes. Yeah, so this A-pillar deflector here, another efficiency.
Right here, yeah.
Another efficiency gain for us. So we introduced this on the current model. Really was from like a soil maintenance perspective to help keep air and or to help keep water moving around the side of the truck for driver visibility. But what we notice is that it actually helps guide airflow around the side of the truck. So we've seen a lot of aerodynamic improvements there. So we did change it. It now goes longer down the profile of the door and it flares out wider. So it creates more space.
So kind of like here.
Exactly,
yeah.
Yes. So if you compare that to the other model, it would be longer and wider there.
Okay.
So you still get the great visibility benefits out of it, right, from a soiling water management standpoint, but
so
now
otherwise,
you also get
Like the water would hit the mirror here?
Exactly.
Okay.
So it's not only a safety, but also a huge aerodynamic gain for drivers.
Gotcha.
Oh.
The side mirror is still here.
Yep. No change there.
Regulatory, of course, requirements around mirrors.
Yes.
But I see something up there.
I don't know what that is, Andre. What
is
that?
There's another. It looks like a wing.
Is
it maybe a flying truck?
No, it is not a flying truck.
No.
Sticking to safety being one of the key pillars there, this is our factory integrated mirror cam system. So this provides a wider field of view for the drivers. It has three in-cab displays, which we can hop up inside the truck here in just a moment and see that. We offer this currently as an aftermarket install, but now we're able to bring this in-house. It'll come off the factory line with mirror cam. And what's great about this is not only the field of visibility improvement, but it also has infrared technology, so the cameras will adjust to the light
conditions,
so you can keep that improved visibility. And they also have a hydrophobic coating on them, so when the water, you know, you're in a bad storm, you can't tell that. It still looks clear as day on the in-cab displays. And because it is proprietary integrated, we're able to incorporate all of our Detroit Assurance safety alerts into those in-cab displays, which you can see once you hop up inside.
Yeah, because there's a lot of driver assistance technologies, right? Like, so lane departure assist or warnings, and then lane change.
Lane change assist is a new feature that we're bringing with this truck as well. Yes.
So it's not just for a driver to see the cameras; it's also integrated into those assistance technologies as well.
Yes, and it really helps eliminate a lot of the blind spots. It tracks trailer distance, so with the in-cab displays, you can see trailer distance lines. I mean, you're pulling a 53-foot trailer, right? Those things are hard to maneuver in there. Mm-hmm. And so now you can set those distance lines to help you better guide around obstacles, and it can auto pan around those obstacles to give you that field of visibility as well.
And we're standing here on the passenger side of the truck, which is kind of the blind zone.
Correct. Yes.
So that's what drivers talk about, is kind of the blind zone. But now you have at least two cameras on this side as well, potentially.
Yep.
And it's an optional feature, right?
It is an optional feature, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
But safety is a big thing, because not just for public, but also for the fleet operators, you know, and the drivers themselves.
Mm-hmm. That's correct.
As well. I noticed this element around the wheel is also new.
So that is the third piece of our wheel well closeout. So previously we offer it on the bumper and the chassis fairing. But now, as I mentioned earlier, right, the wheel well is a really big source of drag, and so by adding this, it keeps air out of that, eliminating drag, and overall improving fuel efficiency by that. So we've added this third piece now that's attached to the hood to help kind of close in all of those spaces that air can creep in while going down the road.
And I noticed even the tires has fuel saving edge, right? So
every element
of the truck.
Fuel economy, yes sir.
We're looking at the Continental tire in this case.
Yes.
22 and a half inch wheel.
Mm-hmm.
So you threw out some numbers in the very beginning about the engine and the transmission and the length. So can we pop the hood, actually?
Absolutely.
So let me get the other side. The other side here. Of course, I mean, looking underneath a semi truck's hood, a lot of elements have to be easily accessible, easily maintainable.
Mm-hmm.
So we can see a giant turbocharger on this side. I mean, it's humongous. And then the other, the DT12, is a transmission. It's a 12-speed.
It is So it's our automated manual transmission. It is our best-selling transmission in the market there. So you get a lot of different performance modes as you're driving down that also contribute to fuel economy as well. And overall, by being fully proprietary integrated within Detroit, that's why we're able to also offer all of those safety features as well, because of the Detroit
all the kind of vertical integration.
Vertical integration, exactly.
Exactly. So let's look at the other side really quick, and you said this is the shorter
length. Hood.
Yeah.
Yep.
shorter length because the engine is slightly smaller.
It is smaller, yes. So on our 126 hood length, we have the DD15, so it's our 15-liter engine.
Normally we would say, you know, 5 liter is a big engine in the pickup truck, but this is a 13-liter engine, which is small for a semi-truck.
Correct, yep.
So, but once again, you can kind of see all the components are easily accessible, and also you could read the levels.
Well, that's what's great from a driver. You know, drivers have to go through pre-trip inspections before they go out on the road, and so you have to check all of your fuel levels, right? Your power steering, your oil levels, you check all of those. So making sure they're ease of access, easy to see is a big driver comfort thing as we go through, and it helps from an efficiency standpoint as they're it's easy for them to quickly diagnose and look at all of these components as they get ready to hit the road.
Interesting. And over here on the driver's side, I also noticed a couple of tow hooks are stored here, and they're kind of secured there with a bolt.
We've got our tow hooks there with tow hook covers that come integrated into the front of the bumper, kind of keeping that seamless look when not, you know, hopefully they don't need to be towed, but they're there when needed.
Last winter, I think it was February of this year, we had a delivery truck stuck in our office park.
Oh, no.
In a snowbank.
Oh.
So
you get those.
It was a day cab, right? It was a smaller vehicle, but still, you need to have access to those hooks so you can kind of help out.
From a safety perspective, yes, absolutely.
Pull it out.
And move it. And then we also, from a safety, I don't know how well you can see it, but we have the safety hood latch over there, that yellow latch down there. So that helps with, drivers under the hood looking or technicians working on the truck. We have that safety latch to make sure that the hood doesn't come down without that latch.
Yeah. That's really cool. So, and those are the majority of changes. We talked about the aero changes.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the technology, but can we jump in maybe this truck?
Yeah, absolutely.
This is the longer model, right? This is the 126?
Yeah, so this is the 126. So if you compare the two side by side, you can really tell it. The nose of the truck is longer here.
Yeah.
And
it's specifically like this area. Yeah, this area here.
This is our most common spec truck here with a DD15. That tends to be the biggest thing that you're going to see in the on-highway segment for us is a 126 with a DD15.
And the DT12 transmission.
With the DT12 transmission, okay. Yes.
But you're also working with Cummins, so you can get Cummins options.
We do have Cummins integration, yes.
Okay. All right, 3 points of contact,
yes,
right?
Yes, always.
Okay.
Safety first.
And we're not moving yet,
no.
So this is just a stationary truck.
Mm-hmm.
But I can see the mirrors are enabled.
That is correct. So this is your 3 in-cab monitors here, 4 mirror cams. So you notice you've got the 2 on the pillars of the door that take up a good bit. And if you look, even if you compare what that pillar is providing you to your side mirror, you can see a greater field of view with that mirror cam monitor compared to the side mirror.
And it seems like a little bit of zoom in action.
You're able
too.
To move, yeah. And so what's great now that we offer these straight out of the factory is that it's integrated into the door panel over there. So just like your hood, or I mean, just like your mirrors when you adjust them, you can adjust all of that over there. So is it?
Oh, I can see that.
Yep. Yes, yeah, so see you're moving. Oh, the trailer line, so you can customize how you want it.
So what is that horizontal line?
That's your trailer. So if you had a trailer behind you, and so because we don't have a trailer, it's not going to let you set the trailer line because it doesn't detect it. But that's why it's asking you that is the driver. It's a driver or a driver feature preference based on where they want to set. So there's 3 different distance lines that if it was detecting the trailer behind you, it would allow you to set it. But since there's no trailer behind us, unfortunately, we can't demo that. But when you get in for the driving experience, you'll get to see that. But what's great there, though, right, is it's all into the door panel as well. Which previously they would have to drill into this B panel here. So you talk about fit and finish, you got a brand new truck that you're having to drill holes into, right? Nobody wants that. So now we're able to offer that.
It's
all integrated.
I'm not used to this because this is a central display.
It is.
In a semi-truck.
Yep. So, yeah, we don't have rear view mirrors, right? You can't see anything there.
There's a home back there.
Yeah. So, yeah. It's very different. But what this is a look down from your passenger side door, because that's the biggest blind spot for truck drivers. Sometimes you'll see trucks that'll have a mirror on their exterior that's looking down.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So that's what that view normally shows, because this is the biggest blind spot for a driver. So now that's a constant live feed of what they're seeing from the passenger side as they go down the road.
And then the passenger side screen.
And then the passenger side screen, the same
basically,
thing.
Yeah.
Yep. And when you set your lines there, it automatically sets here too. So,
gotcha.
But yeah, so what you'll notice too, when you're out on the track, you'll go in under a tunnel under there and it gets dark under that tunnel. Watch your in-cab monitors, because they will adjust to the lighting. And then as soon as you come out and see daylight again, it'll readjust, all without driver intervention. So it's a great, great feature to maintain that visibility.
What about the rest of the cab? Are there other changes, or is it
not
mainly
really
the same?
Not to the interior. We have some of the industry-leading options when it comes to drivers' lounges, from double bunks to office workspace, storage, and everything. So that all maintains the same consistency. We do have some more interior changes up here. So one thing that we didn't talk about is the intelligent braking control system and the intelligent air system. So in the previous models, back behind this dash, we would have airlines galore, and it creates a very noisy operation. And also, technicians hate trying to diag where an air leak's coming from when there's hundreds of hoses back there, right, in airlines. So with the intelligent air system, we've eliminated all airlines from behind the dash. So it creates a quieter operation, better diagnostics, but also gives us the e-park brake. So these are new. If you look at other generations, if you've seen those hard knobs,
plungers.
Yeah. So now they're easy buttons that you can just push to release and pull to apply. They have great LED lights on them, so you can easily tell if they're applied or not, where those knobs before you would never really know. But also, a feature that we get highly requested a lot from customers is rollaway mitigation. And now with this, we are able to introduce that. And so what that is if the truck is turned off, driver goes to get out, but they forgot to apply this, which happens more than you would think.
Yeah.
The truck used to just roll away, right? Couldn't stop it. Well, now when weight is removed from the seat, or if the door opens, these parking brakes, thanks to their brake-by-wire technology, will now automatically engage. Which saves, you know, customers on property damage, keeps people safe from the truck rolling away as well. So we're very excited to be able to offer that feature now, which is something.
And that's now
different.
A standard feature?
It is now a standard feature.
Yep.
You get that no matter what kind of spec configuration you do. That is standard.
And I also heard the endurance braking feature, right?
Yes.
So driving just every day, not just in the mountains, mm-hmm. right? But you're combining basically engine braking and friction braking.
Yes. So, you know, we always talk about the Jake brake. You hear that when you're driving down the highway, right? And so that's normally when you apply full engine braking, that comes from the stock positioning.
Yeah.
But now with this new intelligent braking control system, that brake by wire, that is still an option. But now what it is if you apply pressure to the foot pedal, it will automatically blend that service brake and automatically kick on the engine retarder there, which is great when you talk about extending the life of brakes and brake pad wear and things of that, because now you're leveraging both of those braking components. And then we're also able to offer comfort braking. So the truck now with those electronics can tell how much pressure needs to be applied to the situation based on you applying the foot pedal. And when we start talking about like all of our offerings from Detroit Assurance, you know, we have like ACC to zero, our adaptive cruise mm-hmm. control. Mm-hmm. It creates a smoother deacceleration process as well, thanks to the new braking functionality that we have.
So it sounds like, I mean, we talked about a lot of features,
like,
I mean, the camera systems, the also, you know, steering help systems, mm-hmm. braking help systems. So there is a new architecture, right? Electrical architecture mm-hmm. that's kind of supports yep. it, right?
So we have totally changed the backbone of the truck with the electrical architecture. And that's really where it all starts, right? All these things we just talked about comes from that electrical architecture. So we're able to communicate to the truck at faster speeds. We're able to offer you great business intelligence tools like remote lock, unlock. You know, I don't know about you, I've locked my keys in my car several times, yeah. right? And so now instead of saving on locksmith time, they can easily go into the portal and instantaneously unlock the truck. So is a cost savings and helps with uptime and getting back on the road.
Or maybe lock the truck remotely
or even
well.
Lock. Yeah, yeah, you get a disgruntled driver, yeah. leaves the truck abandoned.
Wow, yeah.
Yeah. So now the fleet can instantly lock it to keep it safe as well. So with that enhanced architecture, we were able to get all of those great tools, as well as the integration of the air system, the new safety features. And we're really looking at that as the platform for all future technologies, thanks to the new architecture.
Because I review pickup trucks on a daily basis, mm-hmm. a weekly basis, and a lot of these technologies, maybe not the camera mirror on the side here, but yeah. they seem familiar, right?
Yes.
Because the latest pickup trucks have remote unlock mm-hmm. and lock, and they have, you know, a lot of the camera systems and a lot of remote monitoring, right?
Yes.
You could check your fuel, your tire pressures.
Mm-hmm. All the telematics data that yeah. you need, exactly.
But for a fleet, large fleet, right? And also driver operators, right? Mm-hmm. Owner operators, I mean.
Yes.
Data is important.
Data is very important.
Yes. So
yes.
You mentioned the portal a little bit.
Yes, the Detroit Connect portal.
Yeah. Do you know how the video capture works?
Yes.
Or what initiates that?
Yeah. So one thing we didn't call out when we were out front, but you can see it honestly better, is that we have a multi-purpose camera in here.
Okay.
So this is a camera housing. Because of the new multi-purpose camera here, we actually have been able to shrink the housing here, so it provides greater visibility and disruption on the windshield. But with this new camera, we're able to offer you Detroit Connect Video Capture 2.0. So it's a forward-facing camera, catches everything out front of you. And so if ever a safety event happens or you're needing, you know, additional footage to evaluate what happened, they can access all of that footage through the Detroit Connect portal and see all of those safety events that are occurring while the driver
is down.
So is
it like a sudden brake event, or
if you get a sudden brake event,
what about
or anything,
a horn?
It does not pick up on the horn.
Okay.
Yeah. But so it's great. And the camera now, with the fifth generation Cascadia and this new updated camera, it's higher visibility and higher quality footage, and they can see things almost instantaneously. So the second that an event happens, they can instantly see what happened in the portal.
Yeah, and sometimes, I mean, at the end of the day, maybe you want to review what happened,
yes.
or maybe there was,
you know,
an incident
great
or something.
Driver
yeah.
feedback and coaching opportunities too, right? Just overall insights into what's going on the road.
So it sounds like, I know yesterday, last night, we had some, you know, big fleet customers mm-hmm. with us, and a lot of, you know, kind of a panel discussion.
Yes.
And it sounds like Freightliner talks to their customers
yes.
quite a bit, which is nice, because, you know, I think I can anticipate some of the comments, right, where technology can be overbearing sometimes and there could be too much of it.
Mm-hmm.
But I can see, like, not attaching it to a horn, for example. I mean, sometimes backing up, you're using a horn mm-hmm. in a regular operation. So, like, that shouldn't probably trigger other events.
Right.
So you want to help the driver not annoy the driver.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah. Everything that we do from Freightliner that we integrate all comes from customer feedback, right? Like I mentioned, the rollaway mitigation, that was a huge customer feedback point for us that we wanted to make sure that we bring to life with that. And so we know with anything, right? Like, we're all human beings, change can be hard for people. And so we want to make sure that every time that we go and we are looking at what comes next with our newer models, that we're constantly collecting that customer feedback. And so we make sure that some of our top fleets and customers and partners are involved with anything that we do, whether it's features like this or software features like Detroit Connect Video Capture, that we're involving them very early in the process and then keeping their feedback coming throughout the entire production point of this. So it's very important for us that we get that, because ultimately that's what makes this a flagship product, is that we keep our customers happy and our drivers safe. And so
yeah.
that's our main focus at Freightliner.
And you're hitting those three kind of elements, right? Safety, efficiency, and profitability, because if you order a package online, you know, at some point, probably one of these trucks carried it to a distribution center or here and there.
Yes.
So
all those products we love, that's how they get to the store, right?
Yeah, all my iPhones, come on. I need my iPhone. So this is very important. So the, you know, freight carrier, whoever the customer is, you know, they need to make money too. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the easier the truck is, the easier it is to maintain, the safer it is. The more comfortable it is, right? The driver wants to be here instead of not being here. Right?
Exactly.
So
yeah, they want to be on the road making money, right? That's what they want to be doing.
Yeah.
And they want to do it efficiently and effectively so they can get back home to their families.
And comfortably.
And comfortably, yes.
All right, but I want to take a closer look into the powertrain, right? Because we opened the hood, but what about the details? Whoa, this is cool. So this is kind of a display from Detroit Technology Company, and you can see kind of all of the components they manufacture. And also, this is not just hardware, of course, it's all the kind of the integration of the system and the software. So let's start in the front here. So we got a steer axle, this is the front. And also it kind of shows the view. So for example, right here is the front mounted camera and the little module that's kind of attached to that. Over here, we have a closer view of the front mounted long range radar that's kind of inside the bumper, the front of the truck. Now the big boy. Now this is this is the big boy, DD15. Detroit diesel 15 liter six cylinder engine. And you can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm about 6'3", 6'3" tall. And you can see I'm a little bit kind of a fat dude, but this engine, it's humongous. And this is what's packaged inside of that slightly longer nose Freightliner Cascadia. This is the turbocharger. You can kind of see the size of it with my hand. This is pretty huge. And the outlet on this side. So this is pretty huge components. Everything is supersized. This is where the transmission meets up to it. And the transmission is this DT, Detroit transmission 12. So 12 gear automated manual transmission. So basically the computer is operating the clutches and shifting gears for you and kind of giving the digital feedback to the driver. Also not small, but quite a bit smaller than the engine. Let's walk around this side too and take a look at this. Massive engine. This is the oil pan. And Miranda was talking about the front bumper skirt, the lower part of the bumper protecting some of the components underneath. And she was probably mentioning some of the components like this oil pan right here on the bottom of the engine. And of course, a lot of you are probably commenting right now and saying that front bumper skirt is too low. What if I run over a curb or something else? And Freightliner tells me that they've tested a lot of different scenarios, running over curbs, backwards and forwards, and having that bumper being robust enough. Of course, it's not a skid plate, but robust enough to actually handle a lot of abuse. Here you can see the other side of the transmission. Now let's keep moving. Axles. Yes. So you can see the input. And kind of, so this is a tandem axle setup. So of course, look at the size of this pumpkin. It's like, I don't know, 2 feet. And contrary to belief, like I would think this axle would be super, super low geared, but it's actually around 264 to one. Like in a pickup truck, for example, like a F-150 Raptor, you would have the rear axle ratio of around 410 to one. This is, 264, 265 to one. So a lot of the gearing is actually handled by the transmission and kind of The lowest gear to the highest gear, those are kind of handled here, because you need to get that 80,000 pounds moving off a dead stop, maybe up a hill. And then you can also get the capability to be a little bit more efficient on the highway. So running 65 miles an hour, 70 miles an hour, or whatever your highway speed is, then you can get a little bit more efficiency. And this is the, in this case, the final axle here in the back. And everything is humongous. It's just supersized for semi-trucks, as you can see here, including the spindles on the end. This is where kind of, you know, the brake assembly and the wheel mounts to in the back here. And this is kind of a realistic, so to speak, length of the truck, because the back of the cab, I mean, these are separated a little bit, but the back of the cab to the front bumper, Miranda was saying, is about 126 inches for the longer version of the truck. So that's about what? About 10 feet. So you can kind of see this is almost to scale, this display. This is quite impressive. It's huge. I love this. I don't get enough time to play with big stuff like this. Hey, even has a dipstick. You know, there's a little recent controversy that some of the engines in the pickup truck world and the car world don't have dipsticks anymore, but this engine has a dipstick. And of course, Detroit Diesel, I mean, they have decades of experience, decades of being in business. There's a little video playing over there. Detroit Diesel celebrated 80 years, I think a few years back. So they're over 80 years old as a company. And they were famous for diesel engines. They started out with two-stroke engines. You could see some of those engines kind of displayed in that video. And then, of course, they progressed to what you see here with really modern and also fuel-efficient technology. I was doing some research because, you know, I don't know all the data on semi-trucks. My specialty is pickup trucks and big SUVs. But I was doing some research on the semis. And the Cascadias, one of the reasons why they're so popular, they're one of the more efficient semis on the road, because there's many other companies, of course, in this space. But efficiency is part of that equation for profitability for an owner-operator or a big fleet of trucks.
Well, like I say, Andre, I am jealous that you're out there driving big rigs.
Yes.
I know that's something that is cool. When you get to do it, you know, at a new truck launch, I'm sure it's something that's probably not as cool when you have to do it for a living and you have to crisscross.
Well, it's a job.
It's a job. Yeah. It's a rough job. But it is cool to see just how much technology is in a modern tractor trailer rig.
Yeah. And there's, of course, mixed feelings, I think, maybe from some truck drivers who are listening and watching right now, because I saw a lot of comments on my other video about the new Cascadia that, you know, remove all the tech, right? I want to drive it by myself once again. So there's a couple comments there. But when I talked to some of the fleet operators at the event, safety, 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 right? Because like you said, there was one case recently near Denver where there was a huge accident and people died. And that could put a business out of business.
Well, look,
it could put a fleet out of business.
It's happening in everything, right? It seems obvious that... You know, self-driving trucks are coming, and that at some point the truck driver will just be sitting there monitoring the truck.
A conductor.
Yeah, as opposed to actually driving the truck, which sounds really boring to me. But let's face it, even in our industry, AI is changing, you know, the business, right? Because AI is now writing stories, and in places like China, they have AI anchors. How long before me and you will be replaced by, like, perfect-looking humans?
I hope not soon.
With great hair and good teeth and, you know, no
skinny bellies.
No skinny bellies that never age, you know? I mean, it's happening throughout the entire world. And so we're living through, there's that Chinese saying, right? May you live through interesting times. And my God, we are living through interesting times. But while we're still driving trucks and we're still, you know, reviewing trucks, let's take advantage of it, and thanks for going out there and doing this, Andre.
Yeah, Roman, and just a couple more comments, right,
yeah.
as we close down. An airline plane, a commercial airliner, flies itself. right?
Mostly. Yes, autopilot.
But there's also two pilots that are always in there, yep. You know, monitoring things because safety is really important. And, you know, maybe that's the future, like you said. Maybe when in 5 or 10 years from now, a Cascadia or another semi is going to be driving itself. I think there is also, you know, a place for a human to monitor this stuff because it's really important because you will not get rid of all other vehicles on the road, right? So that's also very important.
I think it's already happened in Europe with trains, right? Those high-speed bullet trains, I don't think that there are people actually driving them. I think that those are mainly driving themselves, and the engineer is just there to monitor the automation. Which, like I said, seems really boring, seems much cooler back in the good old days. But then back in the good old days, they had a shovel coal, which doesn't seem all that cool.
Yeah. And also, I was just at the airport. I took an Uber home just this morning.
Yep.
And the driver of the Uber was a retired truck driver.
Oh,
and
cool.
We talked about big rigs.
Yeah.
And he told me his route was Denver, Los Angeles. And I said, how was that? And he was like, oh. Winter time?
Yeah.
Can you imagine?
Vail pass.
Winter time.
I dread that drive.
Chaining up, chaining down. Fixing chains.
Oh, I've been stuck on that road so many times. I feel for the truckers out there.
Yeah.
Because it's icy, it's cold, it's snowing, it's miserable, and they're putting on chains. Maybe they should work on that. As opposed
automatic to chains. How about that?
Exactly. I mean, the buses have them. The school buses have them.
Yes.
You know, maybe they could come up with, you know, something that's more modern than what we were doing 100 years ago.
Yeah. So it's a lot of cool stuff. So hopefully you enjoyed this episode, right? It's kind of a look behind the curtain of big rig trucks. And if you like this stuff, let us know. You know, we'll be doing a little bit more. And I want to see where this goes, right? What about Nikola? You know, they've sold like 200 trucks last quarter.
Yeah.
But
what about hydrogen?
Yeah. Hydrogen. You know, is that coming also?
Well, we've done enough stories about hydrogen to know that people like hydrogen trucks. It does, you know, it does solve a lot of problems. But basically, hydrogen trucks are electric trucks, and you're still using a battery, but you're using the hydrogen to then fill up the battery.
Create electricity.
Yeah, to create electricity. And hydrogen is, you know, something that you can fill up very quickly as opposed to electricity, where you still have to sit there and wait for the battery to charge. So that also may be an interesting solution. And you could put some pretty big-ass hydrogen tanks behind the tractor.
Yeah, with the sleeper cab.
Behind the sleeper cab, yeah. So that's something else. We'll stay on top of this, Andre.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, guys, thanks for watching. It was fun. And we shall see you, hear you next time. Ciao.
Thank you.